Hello and welcome all of you to Easy Electrical. Today is our fourth day, that is 4th of October 2021. Today we'll be starting our first lecture on electronics part. And first of all, we'll be dealing with about the semiconductor physics part. So in this rapid revision series, what we are trying is that we are giving you a brief idea. Chapter wise or sequence wise questions are selected, so that you can get a good and quality revision. Now, you must be knowing some of our courses by now, that we basically run an SSC JE online course, and in that online course, basically, we are specializing in one of the very few institutes that are providing recorded courses of the classes. That means, if you do a class for the one time, you will get the complete recording. And you can keep it with yourself lifetime, no other costs attached. Okay, now all our basic things are already included. You all know these are provided for every cases. Now, in today's rapid revision series, we'll be taking up basic electronics part. So to come up with the first question, it is the outermost orbit of an electron can have the maximum number of electrons. How many maximum number of electrons can we have in the outermost orbit? From the given options, 8 is the correct option. Okay, so we know that, like that, 2, 8, 8, then again this number further increases. If we consider this as the first orbit, this is the second orbit, like that. Okay, 2, 8, 18, 2, 8, 18, and like that. So this is the maximum number of electrons that can have is 8. For that case. Now coming to the next question, the energy required to disrupt the bond of the pure germanium. So what is the energy that is required for germanium? That is 0.75 volts. So this short question is basically asked in every other examination. You must remember this point, that 0.75 volt is the amount. Now when the outermost orbit of an atom has exactly 4 valence electrons, the material is. Basically, what we observed in silicon is that in the outermost orbit, we basically find 4 electrons. So, by this understanding only, you can say that the outermost orbit of an electron is basically a semiconductor. Just a typical example I can give you. The silicon is basically 14. So, if you just divide it, you can get 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, right? 2p6, 3s2, 3p2. From this you can get that in the third orbit you are getting only 4 electrons. Likewise in germanium also you can get the same number. So if the outermost orbit contains 4 electrons, in that case we call it as a semiconductor. Now the life of the electron and hole before recombination will be how much it is? 1 second, 1 minute, between millisecond and microsecond based on condition, or none of this. Basically, it is the third option is the correct option. Basically, it takes very little time, and based on situations and based on applied field or based on condition, it may vary between micro to millisecond. Recombination is nothing but when electrons and holes meet together. Basically, free electrons, when they release energy, they will recombine with the hole. Some example I can give you, like that in LED. Okay. In LED, there is a certain understanding that whenever the electrons, free electrons, move from the up, from the downward direction, that means whenever we are saying, suppose an LED is emitting light, right? In that case, free electrons that are present, they come down from their conduction band to valence band. And because of this, recombination takes place with the valence band present holes. And this recombination, due to this recombination, as the electrons are coming down, energy is released. And this energy is converted to either heat or we can say light. Okay, so gallium arsenide we basically used for this type of application. Here the recombination process basically happens. Now the speed of the electron is vacuum. Basically, in a conductor, there will be some amount of resistance, but in vacuum, there is no such resistance. So, it will be much higher. Now coming to the next question, which of the following creates a p-type doping? Okay, which of the following creates a p-type doping in a semiconductor? Basically, what we see is that in silicon, before silicon we have aluminium, and after silicon we have phosphorus. Okay, silicon outermost orbit has 4 electrons, it has 5 and it has 3. Now, if we merge silicon and aluminium together, dope silicon with aluminium, we basically do reduce the number of available electrons or free electrons. Basically, we generate holes in this case. Now, this generation of holes ultimately leads to creation of p-type material. So, from this understanding, we can get that to create a p-type material, we need in this case, we need a p-type material. That means we need a trivalent atom. That means here you can see, if for aluminium, we are having 3 atoms at the outermost orbit, and these outermost 3 orbits will give us ultimately p-type material. Okay, so a trivalent atom must be doped to get a p-type material. Similarly, for a pentavalent atom, if we dope a pentavalent atom like phosphorus, in that case we will get the n-type material. In this case, the availability of electrons are larger. A semiconductor has almost empty conduction band or full conduction band. Basically, what we see here is that in case of semiconductor, there is a band gap, right? This band gap energy is basically of the order of 6 electron volts. This is valence band and this is conduction band. Basically, conduction band is empty. No electron is present in that in conduction band. When we provide energy, in that case, some valence band electrons will jump to the conduction band. So, almost empty conduction band is present in a semiconductor. This is the correct option. Now, coming to the next question. According to Bohr's theory, an electron can move in an orbit of any radius, certain radius, some range of radii, or none of these. From the very basics, we know that it is a certain radius. From Bohr's theory, we have observed that Bohr has said that electrons move at a particular orbit. Okay, so that particular orbit actually means a particular radius, and that particular radius gives us the what particular energy level that he has talked about in his theory. Now coming to the next question, the energy band gap between valence band and conduction band for insulators is 15 electron volts. Okay, for semiconductors it is 6 electron volts, and generally overlapping is observed between valence and conduction band in case of a conductor material. Okay, now coming to the last question, the work function of a metal is basically measured in, see here, what of the options are given? None of the options are true. Electron volt is the unit of work function. Okay, so none of this will be the correct option. Electron volt is the way through which we measure the metal's work function. Now, if you have any doubt regarding this question session, you can directly message me over WhatsApp in the given number. You all know 833-506-7725, or you can mail us at electricaleasy@gmail.com if you have any further doubts. Okay, thank you everyone for listening up to this point. Hope you have a nice day. Thank you.